Hi, I'm Yvette Alfonso. I'm president of the Statewide Board of Citizen Action of New York. Welcome everybody here. Today we are having this press conference to talk about community schools. We expect some of our legislators will be coming by soon. But to begin with, community schools, everything is said in the name of that, a way to assure that our families, our children, get all the resources and education that they need, but that there also be a connection and collaboration with our communities. So to begin to speak about that, I'm gonna ask Vicki Smith, who's a parent from Albany and a member of Citizen Action of New York.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here today with Citizen Action and friends and legislators. I was raised in Virginia. I remember that at the time that I started school, which was about 1967, 68, was the first time that I began to see the kind of parent involvement that I do not see today, the kind of community engagement that I do not see today. So that when I was growing up, I saw institutions, my mother's job, my mother's union, they were organized to provide services, wraparound services to our schools. And the community was engaged with the school community to make sure instruction was what it needed to be. And it's been a long time since I've seen that. And I am now, and have been in New York for 25 years, raising a daughter. She is at the high school in Albany. And it's time, it's beyond time for me and for us to be involved to ensure that every child, not just my child, but every child thrives and succeeds academically, socially, and emotionally. And I believe that community schools is provides a beacon of hope for our students and for our families who have struggled so hard to succeed. This proven approach will expand parent and community engagement in the education of our children, and more importantly, help us to organize our school and community resources through partnerships. That's exactly what our schools need, what our families need, what our communities need to combat educational inequities. So I urge you to support community schools. Thank you.
Thank you, Vicki. Now I want to call up Provi Carrion, who's a parent and a member of Citizen Action. She's from Buffalo.
Hola. My name is Providence Carrion. As you know, Buffalo schools has been struggling, just like any schools in the poor community. Citizen Action been working in improving the schools through changing at local level. We have changed the code of conduct at Buffalo, eliminating some of the suspensions at the schools. We think that community schools are the model that is best fit for poor communities because it provides a comprehensive approach. We are very glad that the governor proposed new funding for community schools. We like to see that father is spending more money in schools for the benefit of each school to provide hours of comprehensive service for the whole family. Our assemblywoman, Crystal Peoples-Stroh, have approved $250 million for the community schools. And I urge our governor to please increase that too. I want to let you know a little story that happened this year. I'm an educator, 31 years of education. I'm a grandmother. It's four generations of public school. And sad to say, my niece came up from Puerto Rico to better her life and better her children. They came in the middle of September. Her little boy started school. By the end of September, he was suspended. We asked the principal if we could come in and help them out, even if we didn't help him in that room, but to help him out in the building. He said that was not done anymore. And we asked in another meeting, the assistant principal, he said, yes, you could do that. But that little boy, if he went from the middle of September to today for a whole month, I didn't see that. My niece had to go back home where she could have her child in school. And if we convert our schools to community school, we will have counseling, we will have health service for family and children, and we will have the attendance improve.
And now, it's actually my honor to introduce a longtime champion of children and families in New York State, and that is Senate Democratic Leader Andrea Stewart Cousins.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Yvette, and thank you, everybody, for being here. It is just so important. Whenever I speak about education, I talk about the education being the great equalizer. We know that the difference between growing up in poverty, growing up without resources, very often comes down to what you know, your education. And as someone who went to public schools, depended on public schools, taught in public schools, I get how important it is. One of the things that really struck me, however, is when the state did this kind of assessment of the schools that were struggling and the schools that were in danger of being in receivership. The amazing thing that we all saw was that these schools were schools in communities where the families of these kids were struggling. There was a clear indicator that the struggling schools were in impoverished communities. And it became very, very clear, and I know Assemblywoman People Stokes is here as well, it became very, very clear that instead of pretending that we can ignore the needs of these children in these schools, we need to focus on them. Community schools work. Community schools wrap services not just around the student, but around their parents, around their support systems. It brings needed services in. It makes sure that buildings are accessible and that every single element that lends itself to making education a valuable asset for each and every child is there. Now, it's not a panacea, but we can clearly do more to make sure that the resources that we know New York State has and New York State can directs it at community schools. So we are looking not only for the passage of our legislation, but I know the governor wants to put $100 million. We'd like to see more resources. I know $250 million is the number that we're talking about here with Citizens Action. But the reality is that if we understand that education is the great equalizer, if we understand that the children that we are educating not only is the present, but they are our future, if we understand that education has to be a priority for New York State in order for us to continue to be leaders, then we will understand the importance of community schools. So let's get it done. Thank you.
Another great champion who's always been out there in the trenches with us, Assemblymember Crystal Peoples Stokes.
Thank you, and it's really great to see all these wonderful advocates here in this room for such a great issue. There's nothing, as my friend and the leader just mentioned to you, that's more important than us taking the responsibility for educating not some of the children, but all of the children in the state of New York. And so I am very honored to stand with my colleagues from the New York State Assembly who have signed on to a letter that we sent both to the speaker and to the governor saying that we're heartened by the fact that the governor included $100 million in the budget for community schools, But we're disheartened that the fact that, because we know that's not enough. And we specifically asked for 250, that 250 million. That doesn't mean that we have to stop at that. It's not a cap. Okay, that's not a cap. It can go way over that because, as was said before by Leader Stuart Cousins, education is about educating the whole child, not just part of him that fits into some little widget that we would like to see everybody fit into, but the whole child. And if you're doing that for the whole child, you must include their family. Now, I'm from Buffalo, and I remember the day, yay, Buffalo in the house. Yes, yay, Buffalo. I remember the day when you went to school, you walked around the corner, or you walked two or three blocks. Now we put children on buses, and they're on buses sometimes for 45 minutes to get to school and 45 minutes to get home. Now, I'm personally not an advocate for segregated schools. I'm not an advocate for that. But I am an advocate for children being able to go to schools in their communities. Because what happened when we sent children for 45-minute bus rides to school is their parents couldn't get to parent night because they didn't necessarily always have a car. Or maybe the buses were running slow at 7 o'clock after they got off from two jobs to be able to make it to parent night. So in order to educate these children, we've got to re-engage their parents. We've got to make it easier for parents to attend parent night. We've got to make it easier for parents who want to go into the schools like my mother did, whenever she felt like it, walk right into the building. We have to make that possible. I think community schools does that. And so I am very encouraged by both the support of the executive branch of government and the support of my colleagues in both the New York State Assembly as well as the New York State Senate. We do understand that New York is really building a really decent economy here. Jobs, we're growing jobs in New York State. But if we don't educate every child, these children are not going to be the ones that take the jobs of the future. We have to create the workforce that we want. And that starts in K through 12. And that has to happen with community schools. Children need to see nurses in schools. In most schools, they already can have a nurse. They have access to seeing a nurse. Children need to be able to see a dentist, perhaps. Perhaps there's some counseling that the entire family may need. That could happen in school, in the communities where the students and their parents live. So the notion of having a school that provides for a holistic child and a holistic family is an exciting one to me. And I can tell you that parents will feel different about how their children are being educated, and the children will feel different about going to school. And as a result of that, we will get a better education, we will create a better workforce, and our economy will grow by leaps and bounds. And so I'm excited about it, and I hope you all are excited about it as well.
It is so heartening to have so many advocates in the legislature for community schools. And in that note, I want to call up Assembly Member Maritza Davila.
I'm sorry, I'm trying to get people out.
No problem. I thank our senator and our assemblywoman for taking on the lead in this very important topic. I'm a product of community schools. My children were products of community schools, and my grandchildren are products of community schools. And I have to say that I am blessed because one of them just made it to fashion industry, junior high school. And the other one got selected for seven different universities. So when people tell you that we need to pour money into our children's future, that is nothing less than the truth. We need to invest in their future because those are our future leaders. And secondly, I admire what you said, People Stokes, about mothers being able to walk into their schools and find out what's going on with their children. There needs to be more of that, and there should not be any segregation. Everybody should be educated equally. It's in the Constitution. Thank you very much.
I know everybody has to get out for a vote, but let me introduce Rodney Bishop. Bishop, please. Assembly Member Bishop.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. Thank you, Citizens Action. I want to thank the senator and the assemblywoman for really hosting this conference in promoting what should be the number one issue for all of us is education. I'm a former public school math teacher. I actually taught at the Buffalo School Public System. And I know how difficult it was as a teacher to deal with a classroom of kids who came in with all kinds of issues. I mean, there were a lot of social issues, there were high absentee rates. We had students who could not see well. And as a result, all of that impacted their way of learning or their ability to excel at its most maximum. So, you know, I certainly concur with my colleagues that we need to invest a lot more. I mean, I would hope it's more than 250, but I'm okay with the 250 million, because the community school model should be the alternative model or the right model for our students, and not closing down our schools. You know, we have to make a decision whether we're going to invest in our kids or we're going to close down, displace our kids, and then risk our kids having to be on the streets, dropout rate being high, or being in the prisons. So we got to pick and choose. And we here got elected so that we have a fiduciary responsibility to give each and every one of our students their constitutional right to a fair and equitable education. That is what we're about. That is what the New York Value is about. And so I want to thank all of you for pushing this. I'm going to continue to stand with all of you. I'm going to continue to stand Citizen Action to make sure that we push for funding for a wholesome model in our education system, and so that our kids, our students, have a promise to dream. Thank you.
Assemblywoman Pat Fahey, my assemblywoman, had to dash off for the roll call on a very important Regents vote, so we definitely want her there. But it's my pleasure to call up now Senator Tim Kennedy.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. I will be extremely brief, given the fact that I just got a text that says, need you here for the vote ASAP. So that usually means we got to move. But I just, first and foremost, wanted to be here to be supportive of this incredible initiative. I want to thank the leader of my conference, Assemblywoman, Senator Andrea Stewart Cousins, as well as a great leader from the city of Buffalo, someone I work closely with in the city of Buffalo, Assemblywoman Crystal Peoples Stokes, for helping to bring this initiative forward. Increasing the funding for this community schools initiative is something that I think we all take to heart. It's all about the students, it's all about the children. It's in ensuring that they have a holistic place to be educated morning, noon, and nighttime. It's somewhere that they can ensure that they have the greatest world-class education at these community schools. I thank all of the advocates, especially those individuals that made the long trek from Western New York to be up here to join us in this occasion today. And I thank you for all of your efforts, and let's get this across the finish line. Thank you.
Before I introduce our next legislator, I do want to call up Lydia Rodriguez, who's from Rochester, and it's Metro Justice, which is one of our kind of affiliates of Citizen Action.
Good afternoon. I mean, the senators have said everything that I wanted to say, but I want to start with my story. I moved to Rochester, New York, through ABW, Abused Women's Shelter. And I believe in community schools because I was raised in one. I'm originally from Puerto Rico. When I got to Rochester, we were going through a lot of domestic violence. My son now has learning disabilities, mental health issues, because he wasn't given the help that he needed. You know, he wasn't given the mental health, the social work that he needed. Our children need to be healed. And not only our children, but our parents. We can't teach our children if they're not healed. We desperately needed counseling. He missed a lot of days because of his mental health issues, going to mental health specialists and counselors. But had we had him in the school, he wouldn't have missed so much time. So because of the time that he missed, he failed. He was considered a problem child, which he wasn't. Anybody will become a problem child if you're falling behind. We're not getting the services that we need in the public schools. We need doctors there, as the legislators have said. We need social workers. We have students that come from other places like Puerto Rico that speak no English. We need not only the students to have that teaching, but the parents also. If we get counseling for the kids and the parents don't get that counseling, then we're not getting help. Our families are still destroyed. So I believe that community schools deal with many issues, not only education. It doesn't put the focuses on the focus on the parents and the teachers only, but on the whole community as a whole. If I come to you and I said, hola, mi nombre es Lidia Rodriguez, yo vengo de Puerto Rico, you don't speak that language. So it's not a disability, you just don't speak that language. You need that education, not only for the students, but for the parents too. Why fail our students? Because they don't speak the language. We need help. We need a community school and resources to enhance our students so they can do better in our future. I have a lot more to say, but short of time, so thank you.
And now I'd like to call up Assistant Assembly Speaker Felix Ortiz.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I also would like to commend the Senate Democratic leader, Stuart Cousin, as well as my Assemblywoman, Crystal People, for having the vision and putting this legislation forward, and also requesting $250 million of investment. As I was listening to Elizabeth, right?
Lydia.
Oh, she left already?
No, she's
there. As I was listening to you, you know, and you're telling your beautiful story about you coming from Puerto Rico. I came from Puerto Rico too. And I came from Puerto Rico at the age of 22. I couldn't speak English. I still don't know how to speak English today. But probably that's probably my handicap or my disability as a result of that. But I usually blame the South because I used to live in the South. So I tell everyone that once I'm in the North, my accent is from the South. So, and it's not from the South of Brooklyn. It's from the South of Puerto Rico. So, let me just, on the serious note, by the way, that was serious anyway. On another serious note, I do believe that this proposal will benefit many students who on the holistic perspective. And secondly, touching on some of the points that she mentioned, when I came here in 1995, I came here with a vision and the understanding of the need of the school system in my district. I represent a district in Sunset Park and Red Hook. I represent a district. I understand the dynamic of being underserved, and I understand also the dynamic of representing a community that is on my left. They're doing better than the middle, and the middle do less worse than the right. And as a result of that, I have included a few legislation. Number one, I do believe in 1995 that we needed a complete approach of having a mandatory pre-K and kindergarten. Today, finally, we're getting into that. Secondly, I do believe that we need a guidance council in every school in the state of New York. Not only we need a guidance council, but we also need a psychology. We need to define what is the role of the guidance council, what is the role of the psychology inside the school system. And last but not least, we also need a mental health provider. We need a social worker that will be permanent in the school, that when issues get identified by the teachers, that the teacher doesn't have the burden of becoming to be the guidance counselor, the social worker, and also the psychology. The teacher should be doing the teaching. The other health professional should be doing the health professional approach to make sure that they can address this issue. This was back in 1995, and everybody thought that I was crazy. Everybody thought that those bills would never pass. And 22 years later, we're still having the same fight. 22 years later, because people in this place where we're standing today never listened to what I was talking about, and she left already. Probably happened because of my accent as a result of that. But my accent has taken me a long way. And let me just tell this. People talk about, and I challenged the chancellor of the city of New York at the public hearing. I said, would you support these particular pieces of legislation? And she sarcastically said to me, and it's on the video, you can look the video, I cannot support an unfunded mandate. And I said to her, did you read the bill? No, I haven't read the bill. But the bill is not an unfunded mandate, because the bill can be funded in different avenues. If we want to address the healthy lifestyle of our children to make sure that our children will continue to come to school, have a healthy environment, then we should take all the junk food away from the school, which is another bill that I sponsored many years ago. And secondly, we should put a surcharge to carbohydrate, to junk food, and that will generate $2.1 billion that will fund these programs in our school system throughout the state of New York. So I will never put a bill in the floor unless I know the fiscal implication has been identified, and I put the attachment of the fiscal implication to the bill that people don't feel that it's unfunded mandate. My dear friends, I'm with you. I would like to thank also the Sitting Action for being here and really to bring all of you to advocate for this important proposal. But we need to have a vision beyond that, and a vision where we can address the health style and the healthy condition of our children, that asthma, bronchitis, emission coming through our community need to stop, and I hope that we can all work together toward that mission. Thank you very much, and may God bless you.
Thank you.
We ended, or okay. Thank you, everybody, for participating. I think you all have lobby visits now. Okay.